proud beside my brother, silent at Muzdalifa. Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in, amma ba'd. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I welcome all the viewers of Peace TV for this unique series of interviews wherein we are talking about a soul-soothing and a heartwarming session on the virtues of the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. And to enlighten us on this subject, we have in the studios our dear Shaykh Haytham Al-Haddad from UK. Assalamu alaikum wa
rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Shaykh, alhamdulillah, in the past couple of episodes, we have been learning about the virtues of doing certain acts of worship during these 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. And in the end, we had spoken about one of the prominent act of worship, that is Udhiyah. So can you enlighten us more on this topic of Udhiyah? Like, for example, are there any conditions to be fulfilled for a person who intends to do the Udhiyah? Or is there anything else related to the rulings pertaining to the person who wants to do the Udhiyah?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulillah. We said that the Udhiyah is one of the most virtuous acts a person can do on the day of An-Nahr. The day of An-Nahr, as we know, that there is the Arafah day, if we want to know more. There is the Tarwiyah day, which is the eighth day of the Hijjah. Then there is Arafah. Then there is Yawm al-Hajj al-Akbar, or Yawm al-Nahr, is called Yawm al-Nahr. Why it is called Yawm al-Nahr? Because the Udhiyah and the Hadi can be slaughtered only starting that day. The Udhiyah should be slaughtered after people pray their
Eid Salah.
Okay? And after Yawm al-Nahr, there is Yawm al-Qarr. Yawm al-Qarr means people are established in Mina.
Okay.
And by the way, the Prophet ﷺ said, the best of days are Yawm al-Nahr and Yawm al-Qarr. Yawm al-Nahr is, some scholars believe that it is the most virtuous day in the year. Even it is more virtuous than Arafah. We'll discuss the day of Arafah, inshallah. So the Udhiyah is the best thing to be done on Yawm al-Nahr, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, is what? Is the slaughter of the Udhiyah. As we said, the Udhiyah has to be slaughtered after the Salah. If the person is delegating another person to perform the Udhiyah, then it is better that the other person and this person perform their Salah before they do the Udhiyah. Because in many countries, as I said, in the UK, we might not be able to do Udhiyah ourselves. Ourselves means we might not be able to slaughter it.
We delegate it to someone else.
We can delegate it to someone else, either inside the UK or outside the UK. That is fine. Inside the UK, that is better, so we can eat the meat and we can establish the sunnah and we can spread meat as well, and the sunnah as well will be spread between people. Okay? So, in this case, if the person delegated someone abroad and there is a difference in terms of dates for Hajj between this country and the other country, then the most important thing that the Udhiyah is slaughtered after your Salah. After the Salah of the person who is slaughtering it or who is paying for it.
So it cannot be done before the Salah?
No, it cannot. In one hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to one of the companions who slaughtered before the Salah, he told him, "Shatuka shatu lahm." What you have slaughtered is acceptable for you as
normal
food.
Meat.
Normal meat. It's not an Udhiyah. So that's why it has to be slaughtered after the Salah. And as we said, that it can be from sheep, provided that the age of the sheep, if it is a ram, then the age has to be minimum 6 months. If it is a goat, then it is acceptable for the age to be 1 year. If it is a cow, then 2 years or 3 years, according to some scholars. Some scholars believe 2 years is enough. Some scholars believe 3 years. And in terms of camels, because maybe this program will be aired and people from Africa or from Somalia, they might slaughter camels. The camel should be 5 years minimum. If the person slaughters a sheep or a ram or a goat, this family, then one per person and his family. One per person.
For individuals in the family,
no.
It's per family.
Per family. If individuals want to slaughter, for example, me and my wife said she wants to slaughter. No problem, she can slaughter and I can slaughter. If my children who are dependent on me, they have some money and they said they want to slaughter, that is good. There is no problem with that at all. Okay? If I delegate it to someone else, then as we said, that he should make sure that it is slaughtered after our salah here. So we said, regarding the sheep or this family, sheep, goat, ram, one per person or his family. With regards to cows, then one cow can be an udhiya for seven people.
Okay, seven people can participate in this one
yes,
animal.
Yes, seven people can participate in one cow, and it will be considered as an udhiya for all of them and their families as well. Same thing with the camel.
Camel as well.
Same thing with the camel. However, if a person wants to make an udhiya by a cow for himself, it can be acceptable. The Prophet ﷺ slaughtered cows as udhiya on behalf of his wives.
Okay.
If, for example, a person wants to slaughter one camel for himself, that is acceptable. That is fine. If two people want to share a cow or a camel, that is acceptable. Not necessarily seven.
Okay.
But up to seven.
So the lesser number is no problem,
yes.
Inshallah.
Yeah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Arba'un la yujzi'na fil adahi." There are four types of animals. They cannot be acceptable as udhiya. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, four deficiencies or four problems will not make the udhiya acceptable or valid. The one who limps, but provided that it is visible, clear, or the one that is ill. And it is clearly ill. Or al-ajfa allati la tunqi means it doesn't have meat.
Emaciated one.
Or the one with one eye. Because it is a defected one and it is less prized. The Prophet ﷺ wants us to give something for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala and choose something that is perfect.
Definitely, because this is a very important act of worship.
Yes.
So the Muslim should be careful in choosing the right animal.
Yes.
As the Sheikh said, the age should be correct for different animals, different age limit. And then it should not have any kind of defect, that which is seen, visible.
Yes.
So because this is a very important
yes.
act of worship.
This is the ibadah. The ibadah should
ibadah.
Be done properly. Okay. The last thing maybe we need to say about the sacrifice is this practice, which is sunnah. In Hadith Umm Salama, she said that the Prophet ﷺ said, if the 10 days of the Hijjah started and you wanted to do the udhiya, then the person who wants to do the udhiya should abstain from cutting his nails and cutting his hair. And in one narration, and also taking from the skin. So he should abstain from these acts. Starting from the first day of the Hijjah until he sacrifices or she sacrifices. Now, what does that mean? If, for example, me, myself, I want to do it on behalf of my family, then this ruling is applied on me, not on my wife. But if my wife wants to do it on herself, she should apply it on herself. Okay, when I want to do it on her behalf and on behalf of my family, I am the one who should observe this, not herself, not the children as well.
Okay.
But if the children, again, any one of them wants to do it, then he should apply this ruling. Now, this ruling, some scholars said that it is a must, some scholars said that it is recommended, some scholars said that it is yani good. So the matter is flexible.
Inshallah.
And that's why we always say to people, don't worry. Do your udhiya even if you have cut your hair, even if you cut your nails. Do the udhiya.
So this should not stop you from doing a more virtuous act.
Yes, should not stop you. None of the scholars said that your udhiya will be invalid if you have taken from your hair or you have taken from your nail, because the adhiya is still valid.
As you said in your previous episodes that alhamdulillah, Hajj and even this act of worship is totally about the submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But yet for the benefit of the audience, what would be the wisdom that which the scholars must have stated about why should a person refrain or abstain from cutting his nails and cutting his hair?
The scholars said that, you know, because the people who could not go for Hajj, they should be given a chance to get closer to Allah Jalla wa'ala by similar activities like the Hujjaj do.
Okay, mashallah.
So the Hujjaj are not allowed to cut their hair, not allowed to trim their nails as well, and they will sacrifice. So to simulate them and to remember them and inshallah to be included in the reward, you do something like this. This is the wisdom behind it.
Jazakallahu khairan, Sheikh. We go for a short break, then inshallah we will resume with the same topic.
Crying out to the heavens on the plains of Arafat.
لبيك اللهم لبيك
لبيك اللهم لبيك
لبيك لا شريك لك
لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك
إن الحمد
إن الحمد
والنعمة
والنعمة
لك والملك
لك والملك
لا شريك لك.
A friendly message by Dr. Zakir. Win over your enemy.
In this age of hatred and animosity, our all-loving Creator has prescribed the formula for winning over your enemy. In the glorious Quran, in Surah Fusilat, chapter 41, verse number 34. Nor can goodness and evil be equal. Repel evil with what is better. You will see that he with whom you had enmity will become your close friend. Do not defeat your enemies, but rather win them over, win their hearts, and win their minds.
Peace TV, the solution for humanity.
Most countries of the world ban bullying. They fight it in their schools and universities. A lot of us are being bullied differently every single day. Some come up to us and say, do this, while others say, don't you dare. Some say this is halal, while others say, nope, this is haram. Are you confused? Do you feel lost? Join me in Umdatul Ahkam, where, with the grace of Allah, we will learn the proper knowledge from the Quran and from the Sunnah, which would help stop this kind of bullying.
Join Asim Al-Hakim in Umdatul Ahkam, next on Peace TV.
Crying out to the heavens on the plains of Arafat.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, Sheikh, we were discussing about the rulings pertaining to a person who intends to do a sacrifice. And we also spoke about the hadith that a person who intends to do sacrifice is supposed not to cut his nails or remove any hair from his body. Is it only for the person who intends to do sacrifice, or is there a reward for a person who does not intend to make a sacrifice but yet refrains from cutting nails and removing hair? So is that a reward or any other reward for him?
The reward, insha'Allah, is for the person who does the sacrifice. The reward is for the person who pays for the sacrifice. However, as some scholars said, when you do the sacrifice, try to include others in your intention. And that's why some scholars said it is good to include other people who passed away in your udhiyah.
Okay.
Some other scholars said, no, the matter is flexible. Inshallah, inshallah, there is no harm to include them in your intention. To say that this is an udhiyah on behalf of my family who are living now, and on behalf of, for example, my parents if they passed away, or my grandparents, something like this. That is acceptable. Many scholars allowed it. As you know, the Prophet ﷺ, he sacrificed two ram with horns. And then when he sacrificed them as an udhiyah, he said, this is on my behalf and on behalf of those who could not do udhiyah from my ummah. From another angle, you know that these scholars, some of them believe that the udhiyah is wajib.
Okay.
The udhiyah is wajib. All the scholars believe that it is a highly recommended sunnah. In fact, some scholars said it's better for the person to borrow money if he doesn't have money to what?
To do the udhiyah.
To do the udhiyah. And all the scholars said that if the person, he has money, what is better for him? To give it as a sadaqah or to give it as a udhiyah? They said to do it as an udhiyah, to buy a sheep for an udhiyah and to slaughter an udhiyah, this is better. Why? Because they are spreading the sunnah.
SubhanAllah.
And udhiyah is one of the Islamic symbols. And it is ajeeb. I came to know that in some areas in India, poor people pay much big amount of money to buy a sheep, and they keep the sheep until the day of Nahar comes and they slaughter it as an udhiyah. Obviously, we should not do this as a showing off.
Riya should not be present in your acts of worship.
Yeah, because I read once that, I don't know in which area, that people, they use this as a culture and they started to show off, this is my sheep is bigger than
yes,
your sheep.
Boasting about each other's sacrificial
about
animal.
They have, about what they bought. Okay? Now, it should not be done like this. I think these are the main rules regarding udhiyah and regarding what can and what cannot be done, okay, for the udhiyah.
Jazakallahu khairan, Shaykh. Now, we, inshallah, we could move on to the next topic pertaining to these 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. And that is, again, a very important topic for our audiences as well. And that is the day of Arafah, the Yawmul Arafah, the 9th of Dhul-Hijjah. What is the speciality? What are the virtues of this day? And what should we as Muslims do, some specific acts of worship, so that we can gain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
Yes. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Yawm Arafah, which is the 9th day of Dhul-Hijjah, as the scholar said, أَعْضَمُ أَيَّامِ اللَّهِ, the greatest day on the sight of Allah Jalla. When we talk about the day of Arafah, we are talking about two things. The day of Arafah for the people in Arafah next to Mecca.
The place Arafah.
The place Arafah. So we are talking about the time and the place. And most of the ahadith that talk about the day of Arafah are talking about the day of Arafah and the place of Arafah. Say they call it the day of Arafah because the place of Arafah.
Okay.
Yes?
Yes.
However, some scholars said that if the people are not attending the place of Arafah, inshallah, they will be included in the ahadith that talk about the virtues of the day of Arafah.
MashaAllah.
Inshallah, it is not confirmed. So we are talking about two things. For example, fasting the day of Arafah is a recommended act by the consensus of scholars for the people who are not doing Hajj.
For the non-Hujjaj.
For the non-Hujjaj. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Hadith Abi Qatada, an authentic hadith in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, fasting the day of Arafah, I have trust in Allah that it will wipe the sins of 2 years. 1 year in advance or 1 year before Arafah and 1 year after Arafah.
MashaAllah, such a great opportunity.
We're fasting one day.
For one day.
Of Arafah. And fasting the day of Ashura wipes the sins of a previous year.
Alhamdulillah.
So this is for the people who are not Hujjaj. But the day of Arafah in general is a very virtuous day. As some scholars said that it is
the best day of the year.
Allah Jalla wa Ala swore about that day an oath. وَالسَّمَاءِ ذَاتِ الْبُرُوجِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْمَوْعُودِ وَشَاهِدٍ وَمَشْهُودٍ. Shahid, they say it is Yawm Arafah.
MashaAllah.
The scholars differ. What is better, Yawm Arafah or Yawm al-Nahr? Many of them said Yawm Arafah. And all of us know the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam when he said, authentic hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, that on the day of Arafah, means in the day of Arafah and the place of Arafah. Okay. Allah Jalla wa Ala descends to the lowest heaven and he is boasting over his malaika with his slaves. He's telling them, look at my slaves. They came from every single corner of this universe. They came for one purpose, which is what? Aiming my rahmah.
Rahmah of Allah.
And running away from my adab. Be witnesses that I have forgiven all their sins. So why did we say that this is in particular for the people of Arafah? Why? Because Allah Jalla wa Ala is saying to the malaika, look at my people came from every single corner.
So those of them who have gathered in Arafah are addressed.
Yes, yes. The people who gathered in Arafah. However, as some scholars said, if that day is a virtuous day and Allah Jalla wa Ala descends for the people in the mawqif means in that place, then insha'Allah, the rahmah of Allah, the mercy of Allah, the blessings of Allah, the bounties of Allah can extend to cover other people who are not attending the Hajj.
MashaAllah.
Similarly, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said the best dua is the dua of Yawm Arafah. The dua of Yawm Arafah, on the day of Arafah, even if you are not in Hajj, no, in particular for the people of Hajj. But again, no one can limit the rahmah of Allah Jalla wa Ala. So maybe it might extend even to the people outside the place of Arafah.
Definitely.
Again, in terms of the maghfirat al-dhunub, in terms of the dua of Yawm Arafah, in terms of the shaitan being humiliated on the day of Arafah, it is because of the gathering of people who are making dua on the day of Arafah. And the Prophet ﷺ said about the dua, and the best dua on that day, again, for the people there, is La ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu lahul mulku wa lahul hamdu wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. This is the best dua. Of course, any other dua will be acceptable. See, these are the main things that we need to know about the day of Arafah. As-Salaf al-Salih used to be very, very keen in fasting. The day of Arafah is if they are not doing Hajj. And one of the scholars, Sa'id ibn Jubayr, he used to say, wake your servants, let them fast the day of Arafah. You should not lose that opportunity. And you know, days like this, even if we are traveling, Tawus, he used to fast the day of Ashura while he's traveling. They said to him, traveling and fasting? He said, yes. They said, but you know, in Ramadan, Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِّنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرَ. You can delay it. He said, yeah, Ramadan, there is a iddah. We can delay it. But this Ashura, if we miss it, we miss it. Same thing with Arafah. If you miss it, you miss it. So if you are traveling, fast it. Subhanallah, it is just one day.
Definitely.
By the way, I know time is running. I remember the mas'ala. If it happened that the day of Arafah is Friday, like 1435, year 1435, the day of Arafah was what? Friday.
On a Friday.
Obviously, this makes that day more virtuous.
Definitely. Two virtues of the Friday, yes, as well as the Arafah, and are together.
And the dua, imagine, the Prophet ﷺ said, there is an hour. If you make dua in it, Allah Jalla wa Ala will accept your dua.
Definitely.
On the day of Jum'ah. But on the other side, the Prophet ﷺ, when he entered and he visited one of his wives and he found her fasting on Jum'ah, he said, fasting? She said, yes. He said, have you fasted yesterday? She said, no. Then he said, you need to fast tomorrow. So fasting Jum'ah is prohibited by itself.
By itself.
So if it happened that Arafah is Jum'ah and we are not going for Hajj, do we fast? Obviously, we fast. All the scholars said, you fast. You fast Jum'ah despite there is a prohibition of fasting Jum'ah. Because here you are not fasting it because it is Jum'ah.
Because of the
you
Jum'ah.
You are fasting it because it is Arafah. However, some of them said, fast one day, at least one day before it, because anyway, the day before it is one of the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah.
MashaAllah. Jazakallahu khairan, Shaykh. Alhamdulillah, we come to an end of the rulings pertaining to the Udhiyah as well as pertaining to the day of Arafah. Insha'Allah, we have another final episode remaining. We will be discussing about the Eid al-Adha. How do we celebrate it and what are its various virtues and rulings? Insha'Allah, we meet in the next episode. Until then, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.